We're still within the time of pause, so we need to take you to Parliament right now. The Transport Minister designate Kwekwe Siama is being vetted right now.
In all difficulties and dangers, in whom do you put your trust? You just took an oath. In all difficulties and dangers, in whom do you put your trust? In all difficulties and dangers, in whom do you put your trust? In the oath you just took.
In Almighty God.
Very well. That's assured. I shall proceed with the next questions. Please address us with on this frontier healthcare services. It's come up and we want to know from you. Have you come across this contract healthcare frontier services?
Mr. Chairman, before we started this frontier services business, I wasn't the Minister for Aviation. But upon the President who nominated me to that office, Minister of Aviation has been realigned back to the mother transport station. Mr. Chairman, upon the realignment, I've had some briefing from Ghana Airport Company concerning the Frontiers Medical Health Services issue. Mr. Chairman, the little brief I received from them is that, if you quite remember, around January, August, the President made a statement that the country was just about to be reopening its international airport, and for that matter, we needed that facility at the airport to curtail the vessel entering the country. So according to Ghana Airport Company, they had a proposal from the Frontier Group saying that they had the capacity to undertake the offering of their laboratory services. Mr. Chairman, per the brief that I have received, so they presented their documentation to them, and then Ghana Airport Company wrote to Food and Drugs Authority to authenticate the equipment or to certify the equipment that the people were supposed to use for the laboratory services. Mr. Chairman, the Food and Drugs Board around August, for the briefing, wrote back to Ghana Airport Company, in fact, certifying that those equipment are the equipment that they can use to perform that activity. Subsequent to that, they wrote back to PPA that these people had come to them, they have found out from FDA has certified that the equipment is the equipment that they can use. So they wanted to go ahead with their normal rental concession agreement that they have been granting to their client at the airport to proceed to engage the people for the transaction. Mr. Chairman, PPA wrote back, which I have a copy of the PPA to them, which I can handle, telling them that what they were seeking to do, that is a rental distinct, does not fall within their payment, that they should use their administrative processes to engage the people. So they went ahead and had a normal contract that they have been like I said, they have been having with their client at the airport and engage the people to undertake the laboratory services testing that they are doing at the airport. So Mr. Chairman, basically that is why I know about this Frontier Medical Services matter. Thank you very much.
So have you cited a contract between Ghana Airport Company and the Frontier Healthcare Services?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I've started a contract, and if anything, I can hand it over to the House.
So upon demand, you can make this available to us?
Rightly so, Mr. Chairman.
Can you enlighten us a bit on this procurement issue? You are saying that they wrote to PPA, and PPA responded that the services or the nature of the agreement falls outside of their mandate in accord with law. Are you able to explain a bit of that? And if the letter is here, you have it, can you read it Yes, to add.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, Ghana Airport Company wrote to PPA, and on 26th of August 2020, the headlines read, re-approval to rent office space at Terminal 3 Company, Terminal 3-Company, to test for COVID-19. Mr. Chairman, the letter reads, we acknowledge receipt of your letter, reference GL 125-6946, dated August 25th, 2020, on the above subject matter, and have digested its contents. However, we advise that the renter of office space, and in this particular case, being rented out to another company, falls outside the scope of the Public Procurement Act at 663 as amended. The Ghana Airport Company is therefore requested to use administrative procedures to execute this transaction. We count on your cooperation. The Managing Director, Ghana Airport Company Limited.
Chairman, just a follow-up to the Honorable Deputy Leader's question. What you read, your own heading, rental of office space, is that what you are referring to as the frontline health workers procurement contract?
Yeah.
Rental of office space. Are you equating that to a procurement process which allowed for Frontier to be taking $150 million per Ghanaian traveler, $150 per Ghanaian to undertake COVID? Rental of office space. Is that the same thing as procurement process to get that transaction done?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, Ghana Airport Company only rents space to people who operate at our airport. So what we could do, or they could do at that time, the people had approached them, they need a space for that function, which they wrote to PPA to grant them the permission to rent the space.
So, Chairman, agreed. You tender that in evidence for our purposes. You are suggesting to this committee that the contract to which the deputy leader asks you, and you said, yes, you have cited it, the contract is about renting of office space and nothing more. Am I correct in suggesting that?
Yes, indeed, Mr. Chairman, that is so.
Thank you, Chair.
Honorable nominee, do you have a copy of the contract with you, please? Please look at the charges, if there is any provision for charges, and apprise us as to, I want to follow up on the leader's question, that the renter, because according to you, Ghana Airport wrote to PPE that it wants to undertake this transaction with another company. They need the approval under a particular provision. They write back saying that the nature of the services, you should use your administrative, internal administrative procedure. Now, look at that contract you have before you, the aspect relating to charges, if there is, and in detail, give us in each category what charges or what revenue Ghana Airport Company is supposed to get or generate from this, so that we will know whether it is only rental of office space or that Ghana Airport Company is benefiting from other charges apart from the renting of the office space.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, the contract that I'm having, I can't cite any charges in this contract. What I normally know is that Ghana Airport Company get royalties from all their clients at the airport. That is all.
Chairman, is
royalties.
Chairman, is actually after Chairman.
Minister, if there's a
if it's a rental space, what do you call royalties? Are you referring to rent?
Mr. Chair, then you should read the which aspect? Read all the charges.
And then, Chairman, just to what Honorable Deputy Leader have asked, Minister Designate, when you are reading the contract, probably you may not have the kind of training the Deputy Leader or the Chair or I have. Read the recitals of your contract for our record. We want you to read. Contract between, give us the names with the date. Thank you for our records.
Mr. Chairman, it reads to agreement between Ghana Airport Company Limited and Frontiers Healthcare Services Limited for the provision of COVID-19 testing service at the airport arrival terminal 3 Kutuka International Airport, Accra. Mr. Chairman, let me check purpose of contract terms agreement. Mr. Chairman,
there should be a revenue portion.
Yes, a standard chairman, provision. 4.21, now the Honorable Deputy Minister is asking for, state that whatever the and Ghana Airport Company, GACL and LANCC recognize that this agreement has been stated by COVID-19, and given the national emergency, have agreed that the LANCC shall pay GACL $10 per test conducted. That's all.
And what are the charges again? What are the charges?
Mr. Chairman, I will come back if I find any charges again. But
Honorable Member, you said you can give us copies.
Yes,
you have extra copies with you.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Yes, I have extra copies.
If you have extra copies, can you give?
No, I don't have an extra copy. When I finish the trial, I can.
Oh, very well. I thought you have extra copies now, which you can look. We could look at.
What is the validity of this contract, please? Yes, when
Mr. Chairman, it's for 2 years.
Now, it came up strongly that the company Frontier Healthcare Services is not even a registered company in Ghana. From what you have seen on the document, the contract, is it stating Frontier Healthcare Services Ghana Limited, or does it appear on the face of the document that this is a registered company in Ghana?
Mr. Chairman, for the information that I have, the company is a registered company in Ghana.
And have you received any briefing with respect to how Ghana Airport Company came to a decision to rely on this company and none other?
Mr. Chairman, per the information that I have, the brief I have from Ghana Company was that this company approached them and they prove that they have the capacity to undertake the project. And I don't have any reason or any information again that other company also approved them.
So, is it your case that those equipment from the briefing you received, the equipment they are using at the airport, are not one of such equipment that are being used by other laboratories already in the country?
Mr. Chairman, when they approach Ghana Airport Company that they have the capacity to do and that they have the equipment, like I said, they wrote to Food and Drugs Authority to authenticate or certify the equipment that they are using. So basically that is what they did. Whether the other people are using other facilities, I do not have knowledge about it.
But I am following up with this because there's this strong view that, oh, Noguchi is there doing testing and all that. Why another company doing testing at the airport. Perhaps some people are of the view that, oh, why didn't Noguchi set up at the airport? I mean, it's come up strongly. My colleague Ablakwa has expressed a strong view, especially the cost. Would you, upon confirmation, impress upon them to look at their charges? We already know that for ECOWAS citizens, by virtue of heads of state coming to a certain agreement, we are enjoying some rebate. But would you consider engaging them to further look at this, since it has become a matter of public concern?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, anything that will make a Ghanaian happy or satisfied, I will do. If people are complaining that the cost is too much, when I'm giving a nod, you all sit down, I'll sit down with them, interrogate those figures. If it is possible that they can reduce it, why not? We will ask for what is good. We want the quality of the product must be such that it will be able to certify what they are required to do. And if it is possible that they can reduce the price, why not? We also that if we can negotiate with them, I don't have any problem. Now, ECOWAS has come out legislating, giving directive that every ECOWAS member should be paid $50. And I'm sure they are complying. So if it is possible, we can have a further discussion with them, saying that non-ECOWAS citizens are complaining. Is there anything that you can do about it? Based on the job that you are doing, if you look about your cost and you think that you can lose, why not? You all make people, you all want to make people happy. And you sit down and say you can negotiate with them. We'll do that.
Have you had the opportunity to get briefing on what is happening in Nigeria regarding COVID testing at the airport? Nigeria. Have you had any briefing regarding how testing is done at the Nigerian airport?
My information is that Nigeria is doing PCR, we are doing antigen. So we are there are two different things involved. We are not doing the same thing.
Mr. Chair, I shall tell the nominee to letter and half and say, I shall tell the nominee to letter and half as a proper way to remain upright. I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
You said you tell him to do what?
Mr. Chair, normally all squares and perpendiculars are perfect points. So I'm only asking him to letter and half to remain upright. I thank you.
Very well. That is not English. Yes, Honorable Ablakwa.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I want to begin by requesting the nominee to have a look at his CV, because the name we have from His Excellency the President is quite different from what you have here. Though you tell us you are going to indicate your first and middle names, we only see Ofori. The surname is Isiama, but your first name appears missing from your CV, or have you done a change of name? Are you now Mr. Ofori Isiama?
Mr. Chairman, what I just said is true. My name is Ofori Isiama. Myself and President, we are all Kweku, so you always want to add Kweku to my name. So if you did add Kweku to my name, that is a reason. But my name on my certificate is Ofori Isiama.
So for the record, officially, can you help us officially?
Mr. Chairman, officially, my name is Ofori Isiama.
Not Kweku Ofori Isiama, as the President informs this committee.
On Wednesday, so my name is Kweku Ofori Isiama, but what is on my certificate is Ofori Isiama.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, the nominee will help us, probably working with the clerk to just clean up a few matters. Page 2, epidemiology. Page 3, the conferences attended in Abuja and other matters. I'm sure that can be clarified and corrected with the clerk later. I want to quickly take off from where the Honorable Afenyo Makin left off on the Frontiers Healthcare Services Limited contract. Can you kindly tell the committee when the contract was signed, the contract before you, what is the date? When was it signed?
Mr. Chairman, the contract was signed on the 1st of September 2020.
So the contract was signed on the 1st of September 2020, which is the same day they began operations, because the Ghanaian airspace was open on the 1st of September. You are telling this committee that the contract was signed the same day they began operations. Is that the information?
Mr. Chairman, for the document before me, the contract was signed on the 1st of September 2020. So if the honourable member is saying that,
you know when they began operations.
Operations. I can't remember, but I know that this contract was signed. But if you say so, I will not argue with you.
Yes, they began operations on the 1st of September. There are two laws. You've talked about the PPA writing to the company to say that this matter. It's interesting that mere office rental is no longer a PPA matter. But let's come to these two laws, the Health Institutions and Facilities Act 2011, Act 829. Section 11 of this law provides facilities to be licensed. 11.1. A person shall not operate a facility unless the facility is licensed under this Act. 2. A person shall not operate equipment in a facility specified in the first schedule unless the facility in which the person operates is licensed under this Act. And if you come to the first schedule, for our purposes, this will fall under item numbered I, section 11.2I, clinical and biomedical laboratory.
So, Madam, Honourable Member, I can assure you that their concerns will be taken into consideration, and I'll make sure that those concerns are addressed. Thank you very much.
My second question, we move to aviation. Why did the nominee shake his head? During the era of President Mahama, when the Terminal 3 project was being conceived and everything being put together, there was a charge called the Airport Passenger Service Charge. During the era of President Mahama, when Terminal 3, KIA's Terminal 3 project was being put up, that and other capital expenditure that the airport company was incurring, there was a charge called the APSC, which was leveraged on to be able to get the loan for the airport infrastructure. Now in 2019, the government decided to allocate 14% of the APSC and 10% of the landing charges to three institutions. GCA, because 77.5% of APSC, Ministry of Aviation got 1.5% per the GCA Amendment Act. And then GMET got 5% and also 10% of the landing charges. Would you consider a reallocation of this arrangement or the law? Would you consider a reallocation of these charges? The reason being, during the financing in 2014, 2015, it was those monies that were leveraged on to be able to get the loans for Terminal 3 and the others. And since then, they have been eaten away with now this law. And so these are one of the reasons why airport company, aside from over-recruitment and other internal issues that went along, this is the reason why airport company, which was a tier one state-owned enterprise, is having such struggles. GACL is often asked to waive APSC when it comes to hard flights. And that has been over a period of time. Quite a few agencies like customs and immigration and so on and so forth also use up space in the terminal, which they did not pay for. So there are quite a number of issues that have given them that issue, that problem, of whereby, like I said, at first they had a clean bill of health. They had a good balance sheet even to borrow on before. And now they have challenges. Can I finish, please? Unless you want to answer the question for him. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I will thank the honourable member to, for bringing this matter to my attention. If I get there, these are some of the issues that we are going to look at it and see how we can find a solution to it. So maybe I can, from a narrative, she seems to have a depth of knowledge in the matter. So maybe I can even consult her to help me in resolving the matter, some of the challenges. So.
Mr. Chairman, that's a very tactful way of getting out of this situation. The last one is encroachment on airport lands. The last one is encroachment on airport lands. There are some sensitive equipment that do not need obstacles in their way. Now, when people encroach and build buildings and so on and so forth around near this sensitive equipment, it can actually affect air safety. What are you going to do about that? What drastic action will you take with regards to that? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chairman, this issue, like you said, is even affecting flight or commercial operation to our airport, because some of the private stations have mounted their mast, and I'm sure, which is affecting the movement and the technical operations of planes and other. My information is that this matter has been brought to the attention of the communication minister to look at it. So, like you said, it is what it is. So we will sit down and see all the state institutions or other people, other private or public, which have facilities along this or around these areas, which is impeding the operations of the airport, to see that you can reallocate them or let them move so that you can have control of the flight. Thank you.
Very well. Yes, Patricia Pidgey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I remember in 2017, when the Honorable Minister nominee attended this house, attended to this committee, the appointment committee, the issue of frequent accidents on the water lake was of great concern. The minister promised that he was going to take out pumps on the water lake. I want to know the status of that lake.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, like earlier, I said that before 2017, we were having a lot of accidents being caused by the tree stumps on the water lake. So when we assumed office, what we did is to identify the navigable route for these traditional canoe operators or the ferries. And like I said, what I've done is that we have removed the tree stumps on this navigable route, Damba, Overbank, Katakrachi, Yeji, Makango, and some few, about 6 or 7 areas were moved to tree stumps. So it has reduced the accident on those navigable routes. That is what we have done on the water lake.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My next question is that in some countries, the countries ensure that advertising boards are placed above their buildings. There is a view that the advertising boards erected along the roads contribute to our road accidents. Do you agree to this view? And what do you intend to do if given the note? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, this issue has come to the attention of the minister. Mr. Chairman, since the advertising board are either fined in a district or a municipal area, we are now in discussion with the Ministry of Local Government, which rent these spaces to these advertising companies to erect them. In addition to that, like I said, the National Road Safety has now become a regulator. So we are going to come out with the standardization, and the Ministry for Local Government should enforce that whoever wants to erect advertising board must first of all take care of the size and the location. So we are now in discussion with the Ministry of Local Government to make sure that we standardize.
Okay, thank you. Follow up on that. Are you going to collaborate with the local government ministry on this?
Yes, because they give the lands or the space to the advertising companies.
My final question. I'm coming back to the trees, the stumps. I've learned that it's of certain quality, and I want to know what would be the use for the stumps that will be taken out of the water lake, if you have a special program for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, my information is that they use it for so many things. But in 2012, my information is that in 2012, the government of Ghana gave a concession on the lake to a private Canadian company. What they did was that they removed what they term the economic value and left the rest that they don't need. So basically, the ones that we can use it for project has all been removed. They concession the lake to them. So they've removed the economic one and they left what they, in their view, what they term on economic value.
Yes. I agree.
Honorable nominee, congratulations. My question relates to water transport. And there is a statement here attributed to you, dated 5th August 2019. And you are on record as having stated as follows. I want to quote. Government of Ghana is engaging the World Bank to develop the Volta Lake as part of a regional multimodal project to connect the country to neighboring countries from the Tema port, unquote. Now, subsequent to this statement attributed to you, I've become aware that your ministry commissioned two studies relative to the Volta Lake and its development. And those two studies were sponsored by our development partners, namely the World Bank and the Korean Exim Bank. My question is, why did you commission two studies in respect of the same Volta Lake and about the same time?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, two studies are going on the Volta Lake, but they are not for the same purpose. You know, the construction of the railway line from Tema to Akosombo or Tranquete at Akosombo, we need to use the lake to ferry the goods from there to Adabupe or Yape, wherever you decide to go. So the World Bank, under the Transport Sector Improvement Project, that TSIP, is financing a study, complete assessment study on the lake to detect, because we want the private sector to play that role. And if a private sector must come in, then the private sector person must know that the operation of the lake, that's what we call North-South Corporation, is profitable. So that is what the World Bank is doing. And the project is being undertaken by Vision Consult, a Ghanaian company. The World Bank themselves did the procurement for the consultancy without involvement of government of Ghana. And a Ghanaian company won. For the feasibility studies, the Korean government, like what I said, had decided that what we term as social impact assessment to develop this landing site, the construction of reception area at the Bido Ferry, we have identified a particular project. So they are causing a study, the feasibility study into that project to determine the cost and the location of these areas. And that is what the Koreans are doing. The Koreans are doing feasibility study according to the social amenities they had planned to construct on the lake, while the World Bank is doing a complete study to determine the economic value or viability of the North-South operation on the lake.
Chairman, if I can indulge you and the Honorable Agalga, just a follow-up, Minister. Volta Lake Transport and its development, you have traveled extensively as Minister MP. I have traveled, I believe Chairman too have traveled. If you take Helsinki in Finland, you want to travel to Stockholm, just around Sweden, and probably extending to some of the Nordic countries. They use the same water source, about the same, as what pertains between Akusumbo traveling through the water to Bupe in northern region. When you do get approved as minister, what will you do to give light to this dream? You know, it has an advantage of reducing the heavy vehicular traffic, Kumasi, Techima, Kintampo, Kumasi, Accra. What will you do about it? Because what is referred to as a World Bank interest is to make that mode of transportation viable for the people of Ghana. What will you do specific should you become minister? Thank you, Chair.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Like you said, the heavy trucks, which is causing a lot of harm or damage on our road, if you develop the lake, not only will it reduce the burden on government, it also cuts the journey from carrying the goods to the north by almost about 400 and something kilometers. So the issues are not, if you're able to develop the lake, it will go into our advantage. That's what I said, that the World Bank, because of the railway line that we are constructing, is causing a steady to the economic viability of the lake. Mr. Chairman, here is the case that you want the private sector person to join you to develop the lake. If you don't present studies which are convincing enough to him, he wouldn't come. So before we can do any real investment on the lake, we must know the cost or the investment that we need to do on the lake. And that's what the World Bank is helping us to do. Thankfully for us, Mr. Chairman, the social project that normally scared the private sector people to do are being overtaken by the Korea Medicine Bank. So now when they come in, they are only in to do what they claim to be commercial operations on the lake. So I hope that if the World Bank finish the studies, we will get more private people now that the social amenities or what they call social infrastructure project has been taken by government.
Honorable nominee, how much is involved in the Korean Exim support? What specific projects are they going to provide to enhance social services on the lake? And when will the project commence? I want the specifics.
Mr. Chairman, the amount, I think it's ranging between 80 to 100 million. I think the Minister of Finance will be able to speak to you because it's part of the Master Facility Arrangement that we are having in Korea Medicine Bank. But I'm sure it's between 80 to $100 million. Mr. Chairman, like I said, it comprises of constructing modern landing sites on about six areas, that is Dambai and Dambai Overbank, Ketekrachi, Yeji, Makango, and Njeri, to construct those landing sites. In addition, they are going to construct a reception, modern reception areas for the passengers. If you go, the conditions with which our people stay there to wait for this ferry is very, it's not good, it's very bad. In addition to that, they are going to buy us two modern ferries to do the cross ferry services or the crossover ferry services. And they will construct a slipway. They will construct roads leading lake, or when you immediately you cross, there must be roads leading to various villages. They will also construct some roads to the various. So these are the components of the project. And when, Mr. Chairman, we are late, I have to confess with you that because of the COVID, the Koreans delayed in coming. So they delayed, they came in, awarded a contract to a Ghanaian consultant. My information is that by the middle of this year, the consultant will complete his work and send the report and the template for the tendering process to the Korea. They will do the procurement process. They will do the procurement tender in Korea. Choose a Korean contractor, bring him to join Ghanaian contractors who will do what we call the local component within the project. So I'm hoping that by the third quarter of the year, we should start the project. But now all the arrangements have been completed. So thankfully, the people of beyond the water lake will have some relief.
My last question. Honorable nominee, I have in my hands the budget statement and economic policy for the 2020 financial year. At page 167, I know at the time you served at the Ministry of Transport, Aviation was a separate ministry, but you're going to, the two have now been incorporated. So I'll be asking you to tell me what your briefings reveal in relation to the construction of an airport in the Upper East region. At the moment, when the Upper Easterners arrive in Tamale, you have to travel 3 miles before you get to the Upper East regional capital. Now, at page 3 hours, at page 168, this is what the finance minister said. Mr. Chairman, with your permission, I read. In addition, assessment was on the suitability of a potential site identified for an airport in the Upper East region. Feasibility studies will be conducted on the two proposed airports to secure funding in 2020. So the assurance here was that funding was going to be secured in 2020 for the Upper East Regional Airport for construction works to begin. We're in 2021. What is your briefing in relation to this subject?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, this matter has been brought to my attention, and when I think that we have some few challenges because of the COVID situation. But then the Minister for Finance has assured me that all things being equal, he will make sure that by the end this year, we will arrange or we will find the funding for the Upper East Airport project. Honorable Member, because I know that's where you come from, and your people will be happy that you ask this question. But be rest assured that all things being equal, we will start the project this year.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. DVLA and online drivers seem to have some issue. And the online drivers were complaining that certain charges were being imposed on them which were not being imposed on other commercial drivers. What has been done to resolve the challenges that online drivers face in this country and to promote the use of apps and other such technology to facilitate public transportation in the country?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, the minister is right. This issue has been a major concern between driver and licensing authority and online drivers. The driver and licensing authority is of the opinion that once they are doing commercial business, then they should go through the normal process as other taxi drivers or other people are going through. The online drivers are of a different opinion. And I quite remember that last year, the Minister for Communication herself stepped in to try and see how you can resolve the issue. I've had some meetings with the DVLA, and what we need to do, that thankfully, if I'm approved, I will sit down again with the Minister for Communication, and let me thank him for the good job that he did. He stepped in when I was away to make sure that the strike action that the online drivers threatened to embark, he could have. So, Madam Minister, let me use this opportunity to thank you, but I can tell you that.
But Honourable Minister, what is the complaint, that they are not commercial drivers?
There's some level of misunderstanding, but that they think that they should be treated separately rather than
because you're either a commercial driver or a private driver.
Yes, because
you're a private driver, you pay for yourself. And once you hire people hire you, just because you use an app, doesn't change it. You must be registered as a commercial driver, even if it's a separate entity, a separate arrangement. But the charges are for commercial drivers, just like taxis. You do twice a year.
Because their position was that additional charges, GBL was charging them additional, and whenever the additional charges are incurred, the company deduct that in from their earnings. And that was where the difficulty was. But like I said, thankfully, the minister stepped in. We have sat down with the DVL. We have some level of understanding for them, and I hope that when we approve, we'll be able to resolve this matter. Whether you should treat them separately as a company entities or as mere taxi drivers, and that they should go through the process. Mr. Chairman, I know because you have come from the area, you are very passionate about some of this, but times are changing and we need to also listen to their concerns.
You know, I'm just a comment. There's a group of drivers operating at the airport. They are commercial drivers. They call themselves hiring vehicles. It means that you're commercial. But they don't want to be treated as commercial vehicles. By arrangement, commercial vehicles must do the road. And it is those that they are complaining about. I even insisted that you must be identified as required by law, the yellow background. They said that will bring down their value. That's okay. But twice a year, you must comply. I don't know what that is a problem, but please continue.
I believe they were being asked to take some kind of insurance and pay certain fees twice a year and certain charges that they felt were a bit unreasonable in view of the fact that they were franchisees of these international firms. Now, I'm not sure if DVLA has some interaction with the Ubers and Bolts and others who are actually the companies that are using the applications and the commercial drivers are franchisees of. But as you indicated, we'll collaborate and see how we can resolve this issue. The Goro Boys still at DVLA. Goro Boys. I know that the...
You're still watching the vetting of Kweku Ofori Esiama, Minister Designate for the Transport Ministry. We're going to take a very quick break. When we return, we'll go back to Parliament. You're welcome back. Let's take you back to Parliament. It's the ministerial vetting of the Minister Designate for Transport.
Cabinet memo then come to Parliament for Parliament to give it approval to start the project of developing the roadways and the light trains. Thank you very much.
My final question. Majority of accidents are largely caused by human error. Human error causes the majority of the accidents on our roads. Now, I know that our law says that the drivers, commercial drivers at least, must have their eyesight tested regularly. What steps are being taken to ensure, as part of probably the driving license approval process, or to have commercial drivers at least undertake regular eye checks to know that they are capable of seeing the obstacles in front of them and are not just driving blind or near blind?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, it is so. If you look at the regulation 2180, it is a requirement for commercial drivers every year have their eye test twice done. Unfortunately, like I said, because we don't have a regulator in the commercial transport area, it is becoming difficult for that aspect to be enforced. Thankfully, National Road Safety Authority has now become a regulator as far as commercial operation is concerned. We are coming to this house with the LI to enable them to come out with the directives so that some of these things will be enforced. They were doing it, but people were not sure whether they should do it people should go and do the certificate and bring it, or there must be a format with which we do it. And these are some of the things that we are looking at it within the regulation. And once the National Road Safety has become a regulator, it's going to be a requirement for any transport commercial operators for you to get your license. You should make sure that your members have some of these requirements certified before National Road Safety will even issue a commercial transport certificate for you to operate.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Honorable nominee, in 2017, when you appeared before this committee, you made a solemn promise that you are going to deploy technology to address revenue leakages at the port. Consistent with that, under your watch, Unipass has been used to replace GCNet, which has caused a number of issues at the port. As we speak now, GRA is calling for the return of Can you tell this committee what was the consideration, what were the reasons why Unipass was used to it?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I think I will start from the last go back. Mr. Chairman, I'm not aware that customs are today calling for the return of Unipass. That is my first. But my second point is that, Mr. Chairman, if you come to the port, the infrastructure is for rebuild the port infrastructure. End-to-end system that is operative at the port there are being handled by Ministry of Trade and Finance. So our view was to put in the infrastructure. They wouldn't operate the end-to-end system. That is it. But like I said, my information is contrary to what the honourable member has said. The last time the document, I think in the graphic or times, I cannot speak of it, the GRA is saying that upon the coming in of ICOMS or Unipass, their revenue has gone up by 6%. That is what I read in the paper. So I don't know what the honourable member is saying, but I will check. If GRA is calling for the return of Unipass, the honourable member, I will check them. If it is so, then I will find out the reason why they say Unipass, GCNet should come back, then I can address. But so far as I'm concerned, I don't have that information.
Very well. Secondly, ahead of the 2020 elections, you made a promise that you are going to build a new airport at Cape Coast and a new harbor. When should the people of Cape Coast expect the commencement of this project?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, the airport, if anybody should be excited about airport in Central, it is me, because that's where I come from. And I want that airport to be built as today. But we need to go through. And I know that the ministry has started something. We make sure that we speed it up. To make sure that my own region has an airport. And I think that I want to be on record that it is during my time that they will build the Cape Coast airport. So I will ensure that it is built.
But will you start this year? I mean, upon your confirmation.
Mr. Chairman, in this matter, the processes are important, and we do not truncate any of the processes. So maybe when I assume office, I will sit down with the ministry for her to see the timelines, because we've given a commitment. But timelines and the process that we need to go through are as important as the infrastructure itself. So we will make sure that we speed up the processes, but not to truncate any of them, which will have effect on the airport. But we will follow the timeline to make sure that within the 4 years, the airport is built. Thank you.
Yes, I'll be there.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Honorable Nominee. I have two questions. The first one relates to an earlier question that was asked about road transport and what you've done in 4 years to make it attractive to both passengers and in the industry players. And you did mention that you had acquired some fleet of STC buses and some Metro Mass Transport Will you be able to share with us the mode of distribution of these, and I'm interested in the metro bus, to the various, across the country, because sitting here as a native of Salaga, I don't think your answer will resonate with myself and my constituents, because we don't have anything on our roads. And if you make a trip there, you feel sorry seeing the mode of transport. If people have to go to Tamale, they get on rickety 207 buses.